Welcome to Opal STV. I'm in London at the office of Callanish Partners, together with Eoin Murray, who is the CEO and founder of the company. So, Eoin, tell me, how did you become a hedge fund manager? What's your personal background?
I've been a quantitative portfolio manager for pretty much all of my working life, the last 20-odd years. And it's a very natural evolution from being a quant portfolio manager, where you've got information about good and poor assets in any particular universe, for you to move from a long-only world to a hedge fund world, where you can actually implement those ideas on both the long and the short side. And that applies whether it's a stock selection or indeed asset allocation, as we now do at Callanish.
So tell me more, what is your background, or where exactly were you in the long-only world?
So I've worked at a number of the larger institutional quant managers, so Barclays Global Investors, Panagora Asset Management, First Quadrant, Deutsche Asset Management. And at all of them, there's always been a push to expanding the horizons with which they make use of the information at their disposal. So it was a very natural shift for me, firstly at First Quadrant and then at Deutsche, to begin to foster an interest in practice of hedge fund management. And latterly, I ended up putting together a quantitative team at Old Mutual and eventually becoming the chief investment officer at Old Mutual Asset Managers here in London.
During those years at those different companies, what was the maximum asset base that you managed in your quantitative strategies?
Given the nature of the quant strategies that we were managing at those different houses, particularly on the asset allocation side, the size of assets under management could be very large on occasion, so well into the billions of dollars. Latterly at Old Mutual, I was in charge of an investment floor looking after about $12 billion under management, covering long only, long short, both quant and discretionary and fixed income equity asset allocation products. So the full gamut of strategies.
How did you decide to set up your own company, and how was the transition from the institutional world now to being a startup boutique quantitative hedge fund?
So the latter part of 2007, beginning of 2008, I recognized that I probably, for me, had a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to go out and establish my own firm. And so I took that decision in early 2008 and eventually set up Callanish Capital Partners in July of that year. I guess the biggest challenge was taking the environment and the infrastructure that I was used to in that institutional environment and replicating it in a small startup hedge fund player.
What exactly were the challenges, and how did you cope with them? How did you make it work?
I think one of the biggest challenges was selecting a group of like-minded individuals who wanted to face that challenge and putting the right team together. And I've been very fortunate in that sense in the three other founding partners who joined me in this venture. Fabrice Kona is the portfolio manager of our Callanish Global Macro Fund. And Fabrice and I crossed paths at Deutsche Asset Management at the beginning of this century. And his background is very much on the risk and fixed income and currency side, which complemented very well my background from an equity, risk and asset allocation side. So the two of us look after the investment part of Callanish. The investor relations and marketing side, we have Christy Barr. Christy and I worked together at Old Mutual. She was very much instrumental in raising the assets that we had at Old Mutual on the hedge fund side, particularly as regards the quant strategies, roughly a little over $2 billion. And then lastly, the fourth partner is Greg Hutchinson, a very old university friend of mine, godfather to one of my children, and he is our operations and finance specialist. His background is in IT, he's an accountant by training, and he's worked all over the world at various administrators, latterly as the head of ops at GAM, the multi-manager fund here in London.
That's really a blue chip team. And not only have you built a blue chip team, you also have what I would say a blue chip investor, a seed investor who helped you really get going.
Sure, our seed investor is a Dutch firm, IMQubator Investment Management. and they are the seeding platform for APG, the Dutch Civil Servants Pension Fund, I guess one of the largest investors in the world and certainly one of the leading players in the move of institutional investors into hedge funds. I think the terms of the deals that they offer are certainly very much in the public domain. So each manager on the platform gets a 25 million euro allocation. There is a fee discount given to IMQ as the lead investor, as well as that they take an equity stake in the management company.
How else have you benefited from the seed investment, and how has your asset gathering been going since then?
Yes, there's no question having a seed investor such as APG through IMQubator involved has been a huge boost in terms of our visibility and marketing. And indeed, APG have just recently confirmed their commitment to seeding an additional 10 managers on the IMQ platform and have given IMQ the go-ahead to raise another 100 million euros to be split between the original 10 managers that were seeded, of which Callanish is one.
That means you're getting additional funding.
That's correct, but it won't come from APG, it'll come from another institutional investor, and IMQubator are working very hard with a number of leads at the moment to secure that by year end.
Can you give us a review of your performance since you launched?
Sure. It's certainly, as you indicated, Matthias, it's been a tricky time for systematic strategies in general. And of course, our first fund, the Callanish Global Macro Fund, we enjoyed just under 10% in our first year, with no significant drawdowns, which, that's to us, that was a good start, and we'll aim to continue down that vein.
So what are some of the challenges in the markets right now for your strategy, and how do you deal with them?
It's been a very challenging environment, I think, for all strategies, and I think we've probably seen that in the numbers, particularly this year. I think particularly for quants, whenever you have a degree of government or central bank intervention in the capital markets, quantitative models, by their very nature, are going to find it difficult to understand and to be able to deal with those situations. So I think given that, I think we've actually done pretty well. I'm quite pleased with the way things have gone so far. Our performance this year is just a little over 1.5% year to date, which isn't as much as we'd like. But by and large, given the number of natural disasters, man-made disasters, the ongoing conflict in the Middle East and North Africa, I think we're pretty pleased with where we are. And with the end of quantitative easing, I think we're hopeful that sort of more normal fundamentals will begin to reassert themselves in the markets, and we'll enjoy a really good second half to 2011.
What are some of the factors that you include in your model?
So as of today, we concentrate on the three asset classes: equities, government bonds, and currencies, and investing at the market and currency level. And we have an additional model running away in the background that also covers commodities. We look at a range of different alpha signals. So they cover both fundamentals as well as macro themes. And then we've also got one or two technical signals in there just to add to the diversification. And I'm using technical in its very broadest sense. So any signals which mainly include price or derivative of price style information. The idea is that so we diversify not only across the three asset classes, but also across these different themes, and then across different time horizons as well. So we'll have some signals which have quite a short investment horizon, perhaps just 2 to 3 weeks, and others with a much longer investment horizon. We're also very willing to use information from one asset class to help forecast another asset class. So for example, we make use of currency information in forecasting our equity returns. We also make use of bond information and yield curve information in forecasting currency returns. So it's all trying to put together a very diversified set of alpha signals, which will allow us to generate these strong returns whilst not leaving us vulnerable to any one particular theme or style. We're trading equity index futures, government bond futures, and currency forwards across about 35 different currency markets. And our capacity, as you'd expect in those instruments, is quite large, probably running into the several billion dollars under management. However, we're determined to build a very sustainable business here. want our macro fund to be the first of many strategies that we'll bring to the market in the future.
So Eoin, this month we are at early July of 2011. You are one of the few funds that are actually up for the year, which of course is also a result of your risk management. What is the speciality of your risk management?
So Fabrice and I have chosen to split our day-to-day responsibilities so that he very much focuses on day-to-day portfolio management, whereas my focus is on risk management, both of us also covering research side as well. And that means that should anything ever threaten the portfolio or some sort of dislocation in the market, I'm able to take an independent decision on reducing the exposure of the fund or not. And that's very deliberate. Even though we're quants, of course, the person with day-to-day portfolio management responsibility inevitably becomes somewhat wedded to their positions. And it is difficult even for a quant to take that, or to have the objectivity to take that kind of decision. We use our own proprietary risk tool, which we're very, very happy with. It's a range-based risk model, which does a very good job, perhaps even slightly conservative, of helping us to manage risk. And in addition to that, I also make use of a couple of off-the-shelf packages just to supplement my overall picture of the risk of the portfolio. I think we come from a school of thought which says you can never have too much information about risk and you'll never have a full picture, so the more information provided is good is always going to be better.